Good afternoon, everyone. Just in short, I want to give you some background that you might have picked up from Michelle's presentation, but it's important to see the CITES Convention in the right context, especially in terms of the importance of international trade. And we have similar slides in terms of that, so I'm just going to scan over them just to reflect on the importance of this convention for South Africa and for our sub-region. And then I just want to also inform you about the ministerial lechotla that we had. CITES normally do not have a high-level ministerial section, but we felt that it was very important to have a ministerial segment to share some of the issues of concern that we have in our region. And then key outcomes with the focus, of course, on working documents. As you now all know, CITES regulates international trade, and that's a very important issue to remember. It regulates international trade and not necessarily national trade. And that is something that came up a lot at the COP. We are one of the first parties. We joined in 1975. And at the moment, there's 183 signatories. Tonga just joined a few weeks before the COP and actually attended. And then, of course, we hosted the COP. We were very proud to host the COP. A lot of people refer to this COP as the best COP ever. So we are very happy that people experience South Africa in such a positive way. And then, of course, 152 parties attended the COP. That is the highest number ever, of ministers that were in attendance because of the ministerial lechotla, giving it some political emphasis, I think, which is important because it is actually a trade convention. And then we planned for 2,000 participants, and we ended up with more than 3,500 participants. So you can think of the logistical nightmare that actually presented. But despite that, everyone enjoyed the COP very much, and it was hugely successful. And then, of course, Michelle took you through some of the proposals, but we have a whole process before the time involving a number of government departments. We had stakeholder workshops, etc., to formulate our national position, and that national position was approved by Cabinet prior to the COP. So as I mentioned, CITES is about international trade, and a lot of people always want to make it more than that. I can understand it, especially when species conservation issues are at stake. But CITES cannot do more than the mandate that it has in terms of the legally binding text of the convention. And the trade is defined in terms of that text of the convention as only import, export, re-export, and introduction from the sea. So when we try and use this convention to address challenges and frustrations that we have at a national level, it is not the appropriate tool. I mean, we need to find a way to use the right tools to address that. Michelle has now eloquently explained to you science-based decision making. We always tell everyone that this is a science-based convention where we have criteria that determine what should be listed on what appendices. And that is very important. There's a significant trade review process that's also science-based. So it's important to have science-based decision making. And as South Africa that's promoting evidence-based decision making, that is very important to us as well, to uphold that in terms of the convention. And in Appendix 1 and 2, I'm not going to explain, but just want to emphasize, and I think Michelle also alluded to it, the fact that there's criteria to be met. And when people get emotional about certain species, it's very difficult to continue to understand that. But it speaks to the integrity of the convention. If we agree to certain criteria that must be in place for a species to be listed, that should be honored. Because remember, as 183 countries, we agree that those are the rules that we work by. And we cannot move around outside those rules because we want to address certain specific issues. So it's important to keep that in mind. Then Michelle also looked at this in terms of the importance of international trade. So prior to the COP, you might have heard people saying, Africa should just leave this convention altogether. So I thought it's important to bring this in here. To show that although a lot of attention is given to elephants and rhinos and marine issues lately, actually the most trade is taking place in other species, like plants, reptiles, parrots, etc. And that is why this convention is important, because it gives a basis on which all parties can trade. And we recognize the permitting system, we recognize the methods that we use to issue permits, and that is important for us in terms of the bigger picture, in terms of international trade. And then for South Africa, of course, our main exports that Michelle have also mentioned, it does not necessarily relate to elephants and rhinos and so forth, and lions. So it's the other species that are of such importance to South Africa in terms of ensuring a sustainable trade. And that is what the convention is about. It's about ensuring the sustainability of the international trade to ensure that we don't overutilize our wild resources. And I'm sure you've seen this, and yet again, this is why it's important. We are trading with countries that are not even on our continent. And therefore, this is very important for us to ensure that we have relationships with those countries, that we understand one another's rules and procedures. Outside of CITES, there are stricter domestic legislation that countries adopt. And it's important for us to understand what that entails, how we must work within that framework to ensure legal and sustainable trade. So in terms of the ministerial agenda, this is the high-level segment that we had the day before the COP officially opened. And we looked at the nexus between the 2030 agenda for sustainable development and the sustainable development goals that were adopted in December 2015, and how it interacts with this, the CITES Convention. As I mentioned earlier, in 1975, this convention came into force. That is way before we had the Rio process, before we had sustainable development issues around development of SDGs, etc. And so if you look at the text of the convention, it's very science-based and it's focusing on what is the detriment of trade to the species involved, and you must always ensure legal acquisition. So it does not take into consideration the socio-economic issues that we are dealing with in today's times. And so what we wanted to do through this ministerial agenda is just to highlight to people that we must keep in mind that in a broader framework, we're working within the Sustainable Development Goals, and it's important that CITES should adapt to ensure that it takes into consideration socioeconomic issues of importance. And that's why you would see a big emphasis on livelihoods issues, how to involve communities in decision making, and how can we address the socioeconomic issues of importance. The opening ceremony, it was very well received. It was the National Heritage Day, so we brought in a little bit of flavor of our natural heritage. We had drumming. Everyone enjoyed that, except that they wanted to keep the drum. And of course, our budget didn't allow for us to buy people drums. But people enjoyed it. We had a rhino that came onto the stage. You can see there in the corner. And it was very well done. So spirit or vibe was set for the discussions at the COP. Now, you heard about the proposals. There were more than 120 documents that we discussed, of which 62 were proposals. The rest were what we call working documents that end up in resolutions or decisions. And in that regard, South Africa submitted 5 important working documents that I will reflect on as we go forward. I just want to say congratulations to the Scientific Authority and Michelle and her team that worked very hard in terms of the proposals that South Africa submitted. They went through by consensus, no voting, which meant that everyone was happy that the criteria is satisfied. And a number of parties actually acknowledged South Africa's conservation successes. So I think that was well done. In terms of working documents, the 5 working docs we submitted, the first one was about empowering the next generation. How do we get the youth involved in conservation and in CITES issues? We did this together with the United States of America, and the outcome of that was a resolution and some decisions relating to how we can involve the youth moving forward. And we had one of our youth participants that participated in the youth conservation program that we are in the process of establishing. She attended and actually made an intervention during the plenary that was very well received. In terms of illegal international trade in wildlife, although South Africa proposed initially a resolution in this regard, what we did agree to is that we should take the concepts in the document and include it in the resolution on enforcement and in some issues on CITES and livelihoods that we included. Then we submitted a document on trade in hunting trophies. And at the same time, the EU also submitted a document on trade in hunting trophies because hunting trophies is such a controversial issue in the last year or so. And we managed to, before the COP, actually have discussions in terms of how we can join these two proposals into one. And at the COP, we finalized those discussions and we adopted one document for the process moving forward. What is important is that a decision was adopted to also review our national leopard quota. So those of you that don't know, we have a COP-approved leopard quota, and it, for this year, we did not allocate any quotas in South Africa, and there was a decision adopted that range states should in fact, review those quotas and give feedback through the Animals Committee moving forward. In terms of hunting trophies, what I just wanted to show quickly here is here we have the highest income generated species in terms of trophy hunting. You can see only two of those are CITES listed, lion and white rhino. But whatever happens in CITES sort of sets the scene for what countries decide in terms of other hunting trophies. So that is why it's so important for us to make sure at the CITES platform, where CITES species are involved, we set the right standard. And so in that resolution, we have now reference to monitoring system, adaptive management issues, making sure that there's proper regulatory frameworks in place to regulate hunting. And in another issue of concern, because of the controversy of hunting, involving hunting, is that although our income generated from hunting is increasing, probably due to the poor rand, the number of hunting clients visiting South Africa is decreasing year on year. And that, of course, is of concern. So we must be able to demonstrate that we have a proper system in place to manage hunting trophies moving forward, starting with the CITES platform, of course. Then important document, especially for Michelle, was a document on cycats. A lot of focus, as I say, in CITES is on elephants and rhinos and lions, etc. But cycats and plants are just as important. So a document that we proposed was adopted with a slight amendment by the Secretariat, and this will assist us in terms of getting information on what is happening in terms of cycat trade, legal and illegal, if there's confiscations, that to be communicated, DNA samples to be taken, etc. And we will see after the first year or two what information are we getting in terms of what is happening with cycat trade. Then the decision-making mechanism for a process of trade in ivory. This, of course, was very controversial. And it comes back from a process in 2007 where a compromise was reached around the trade in ivory. And it was agreed that for 9 years, the countries that's on Appendix 2 will not ask for a trade in ivory, provided this mechanism is developed, an African Elephant Action Plan is developed, and we contribute to other programs involving monitoring like Mike and Eaters about illegal killing of elephants and the elephant trade information system. But this, of course, was not delivered by the Standing Committee. So what Namibia, South Africa, and Zimbabwe decided is, in terms of a principle that we need to communicate, in terms of negotiating in good faith as countries, there should be delivery of something in this regard. So we proposed what we would consider a DMM, a mechanism, and that was not adopted by the COP. There's lots of concerns about the levels of poaching, of course, etc. But this mechanism would not have said that we can trade immediately, but that there's a process that will unfold that will eventually lead to decision-making relating to ivory. So this brings to an end the controversies around the DMM. It caused a lot of tension between the African elephant range states, and we feel that we can now start with a clean slate, and we can discuss as African countries what is best for Africa. And of course, in that regard, we are promoting the implementation of the African Elephant Action Plan moving forward. And then countries that would like to do so are free to submit a proposal to the next COP to ask for a trade in ivory. Then other documents of importance to South Africa, there's a whole list, of course, involving elephants and lions and rhino, etc. Also demand reduction and traceability, enforcement and CITES and livelihoods. But I think the most important thing is in the bottom there, the concerns that we raised, and it relates back to what I said when I started, the mandate of the COP and the scope of the convention and what is allowed to make decisions on and what not, implications for range states, criteria for listing, the socioeconomic implications of decisions, and of course, because trade is so important for South Africa, to secure a legal, sustainable trade moving forward. On the elephant issues, there was a proposal to close all domestic ivory markets. Now, this is one of the issues that we felt was outside the scope of the convention, because the convention cannot tell us, as parties, we need to close down a domestic market. But if there's linkages to between the national market or the domestic market and the international market, then of course we can agree to that. So the document that was adopted in the end requested or urges parties to close domestic market where that market contributes to an illegal trade or to poaching. So we have mechanisms in place to monitor these type of things, like Mike, the monitoring of illegal killing of elephants, where you can see where elephants are being poached, linked to the ETA system, which is the Elephant Trade Information System, which shows you where confiscations are taking place. So there are mechanisms in place that will allow us to see where are these linkages between these markets. And of course, from South Africa's side, we have a very limited national market, basically for knife handles, etc. So it's not a huge market, but it is regulated in terms of NEMBA and provincial conservation legislation. Then there was also a proposal to destroy or destruct all ivory stockpiles. And that was amended during negotiations to rather focus on what is good best practices for management of stockpiles. This is very important because if stockpiles are not managed appropriately, they leak into the international market. So there will be guidelines coming out for stockpile management. And in addition to that, also looking at guidelines for disposal, because a number of countries have said that they will destroy their stockpiles, but there's no proper inventory prior to such a destruction event. There's no monitoring systems in place. So we don't know what is the impact of these destruction events. Is that increasing scarcity of ivory? What is happening in the market in response to these destruction events? And then I'm not going to look at the proposal, but there was also a decision adopted relating to trade in live Asian elephants. There was a study done prior to the COP, and there were lots of concerns about the trade in Asian elephants moving forward. Then I'll skip the Swaziland proposals, but there was a lot of documents on, of course, rhino in terms of resolutions and decisions. The decisions that were adopted asked for missions to Mozambique and Vietnam. To see what progress they are making in terms of their fight against illegal trade. So the Secretariat will visit those countries and a report will be produced. Then also very important for South Africa is that we have to submit to the CITES Secretariat information relating to our rhino horn stockpiles by 28 February each year. This is important because we can see how things change in terms of stockpile information and whether that aligns to what would be natural mortalities, confiscations, etc. So that's a new requirement going forward. An important one for us is the definition for appropriate and acceptable destinations. So rhino is on Appendix 2 for the exclusive purpose of allowing hunting trophies and live exports to appropriate and acceptable destinations. That has been defined through a resolution. But what has happened at the COP is they added to that to say that that export should contribute or promote in-situ conservation efforts, which is important because we would like to see that. And in addition to that, it also encouraged parties to put conditions on permits to say that if we are exporting rhino outside its natural range, that those countries will not be able to use those rhinos or its progeny for commercial purposes. Okay, so you've heard about a number of initiatives or projects that's coming up. In Vietnam, someone wanting to export to Texas. So what it basically means is that once you've now exported rhino to Texas, which is a non-range state, you cannot use those rhinos or its offspring for any commercial purposes, including hunting. So it's quite strict. And because America was pushing for this, you can be assured that will be implemented. And then we will also do further work in terms of what is the definition for suitably equipped to house and care for specimens, because that's part of the definition for appropriate and acceptable destinations, and that is also important for South Africa in terms of rhino exports. And then you've all heard about biofabricated rhino horn, synthetic horn, that has emerged over the years. And what we did is adopt a decision on how are we implementing or interpreting the term parts and derivatives. Will that include biofabricated horn and synthetic horn or not? Then African lion, as Michelle said, the proposal was not adopted as is. It was actually amended to include an annotation. The annotations are listed there as they were adopted. Important for South Africa is that no lion bone from wild origin will be allowed for export for commercial purposes. And as South Africa, we need to establish an annual export quota for bones from captive breeding facilities. This is important, but it should not be seen in isolation. Important decisions were adopted relating to studies to be undertaken, and one of those studies is, of course, in the illegal and illegal trade in lion, including lion bones, and also doing a comparative analysis type of study, I don't know what that will entail, to look at what is happening in terms of lion hunting. As Michelle have said, some countries that allow hunting, the populations are increasing. But there are a few countries where they allow hunting, where the populations are decreasing. So what are the governance structures in place to that will assist them, countries that are allowing hunting, to use it in a sustainable manner, still allowing the populations to grow? So in terms of the annotation on the zero quota for wild derived bones and the one for the captive breeding operations, this must be seen in the context of the study. So you know that TRAFIC already did a study in South Africa on this issue, and they're busy with a study in the other parts of Africa. So we need to get an understanding of what is happening there. I know a lot of people were disappointed that we have a quota for captive breeding facilities, but as a government, we felt that we need to make an informed decision. And knowing that the trade has shifted from tigers to lions in South Africa, we were concerned that if that bone trade was taken away completely, the pressure might shift to our wild populations. And our wild populations are just not of a size that can sustain such an offtake moving forward. So that quota will be established by the scientific authority. We will consider exports to date. We will consider what number of bones can be sustainably produced by these facilities. And then, of course, all of this will be re-evaluated at the next COP. Demand reduction and traceability, this is important for us. Traceability in terms of crocodile skin trade, you saw that that is one of the key things that we are trading in, and there's a move to develop a global traceability system. So there will be a working group established intersessionally that will look at this, and South Africa will continue to participate in that, in those discussions. In terms of demand reduction, a number of decisions adopted, as well as a resolution to look at reducing demand for illegally sourced specimens. What is very important there is the review of current initiatives and the development of guidelines. We are concerned that there's no proper monitoring system that looks at the effectiveness of these interventions. So they end up being awareness raising and not really changing behavior of people in terms of the use of wildlife products. So we need more information in terms of what are motivating people to buy, why are they buying these products, and how can you really influence that decision-making process moving forward. African grey, I'm not going to discuss too much, just to say that a decision was adopted to facilitate the registration of breeding facilities up to COP 18, and the team has initiated the process to start working on that moving forward. And then enforcement is always an important issue at the COP. Amendments were made to the enforcement resolutions, and a number of decisions were adopted. An important resolution also aimed at countering corruption was adopted. And I think that is very important because we know a lot of time permitting processes, et cetera, are used to facilitate illegal trade. And so a specific resolution on that regard has been adopted. And I'm not going to read through all the other enforcement ones. I just want to get to CITES and livelihoods. I'm almost done. Here we have a decision that looks at how we can use a toolkit to measure the impact of CITES decisions on our communities and livelihoods. And this is important for us moving forward because every time a decision is made at CITES, it impacts people's livelihoods. But what is also important is really looking at new case studies on where legal trade has contributed to people's livelihoods. A lot of time we make all these statements about the importance of legal trade and international trade to communities, but it's important that we actually develop case studies in that regard and show the evidence of that taking place. And then important also that South Africa contributed is to engage rural communities in combating illegal wildlife trade. We've heard about the green militarization, etc., and we thought it's important to highlight the need to involve your communities in all your interventions relating to international trade and to ensure that their capacity to use resources sustainable is secured. And then rural communities, there was a proposal to establish a rural communities committee that did not succeed, but the decision was adopted to look intersectionally on how we can better involve rural communities in the CITES processes, recognizing their important role that they play. And the closing ceremony, we handed over a blue crane. That is a blue crane. That. to Sri Lanka, who will be hosting COP18. All the best to them. But yeah, so you can see the Minister of International Relations was also there. We had a performer singing. She sang lovely. And we had the South African flag waving. It was a very nice event. And we managed to close one day early, despite the huge agenda that we had. So that in short, it doesn't cover everything. I just need to make that statement. But I try to highlight the key issues for South Africa moving forward. Thank you.